the European identity. You know that in 1945, at the end of the World War II, Germany, Italy, France, mainly the losers, realized that after repeated wars in Europe, each nation had become weaker than it was before. It was a very important realization, and two strong powers were, on the one hand, the USA, on the other hand, the USSR, and they had to decide how to catch up, how to defend themselves in this losing position. Of course, there was another liability. The destiny of Eastern Europe was omitted from this process of restoring the lost power. And the Cold War resulted in disbalance in Europe. So there was a prosperity development, democratization in Western Europe, which led to the path of the European Union, which I will reconstruct pretty soon. And there was this disadvantaged backward Eastern Europe dominated by the USSR. But the option was open to unite for the countries of Western Europe, who were dominated by the USA, but not in the way as Eastern Europe was dominated by the Soviet Union. How was the path to the European Union? You know, or I just give you some points of reminders. There were the dreamers, the European dream, Jean Monnet, Konrad Adenauer, Robert Schuman, Paul Henri Spaak, Addis de Gasperi. Without them, the European Union would never have established. On 18th April 1955, six Western European nations signed the treaty establishing the European Coal and Steel Community. This was the founding moment leading to the extent of the European Union as you know today. On 21st March 1957, the Paris Treaty founded the European Communities. The expansion that happened after the collapse of the USSR with the disappearance of the Iron Curtain and the merger of the two Germanies, it was immediately an automatic step following the collapse of the USSR. Then, on May 1st, 2004, the inclusion of the countries of Eastern and Central Europe did happen. And the last, perhaps not the most fatal step in the development of the European Union was the act of Brexit, but I hope that Brexit won't affect what I'm going to tell you about the future. The unification process was not to be stopped, and I think it's a very important observation that since 1985, from the Schengen Convention, a slow but gradual process of unification in psychological sense did happen. There was the establishment of the European flag in 1986, then before already they established the European anthem without text, just the music, as you know, the Beethoven's Ode to Joy. And in 2007, the Lisbon Treaty created a single legal personality of the Union. And in 2002, a common currency, euro, was founded. So there are some frameworks on which we can at least think about that what will be the psychological infrastructure. And this is what I'm going to tell you, because without European persons who identify themselves with Europe, of course we cannot talk about a physical and viable European single legal personality. The leading bodies of the European Union, as you know, represent a very complex, I would compare to Franz Kafka's castle system, where there is a council, the commission, the court of justice, the central bank, parliament, there is a kind of European citizenship, and the question still remains, and I highly agree with Henry Kissinger, who once, maybe ironically or cynically, asked that if I want to talk to Europe, who should I call? And this is a problem. This is a problem what I want to discuss with you. Some lost illusions we have to take to our countries. The European Summit in Lisbon in 2000 envisioned reforms aimed at the global competitiveness of the Union focusing on R&D, research and development, innovation, and ICT. And the decision was to become the most competitive and dynamic knowledge-based economy by 2010. So that was the goal that Europe had to reach. But turned out that 2010 passed and the dream has not been accomplished. When I was young, I remember very well that Khrushchev, that time the party secretary of the Communist Party in Moscow, had similar dreams, and he prophesied all the time that the Soviet Union would catch up to the United States, and he disappeared. And I am very, very much afraid that this kind of empty statements can be compared to statements of Khrushchev. So the deadline has been extended to 2020. Let's wait what will happen. But in the meantime, what happened? Lost grounds in the world economy, the share of the European economy diminished and is going to diminish further. And what's the most important problem, and this is what I will concentrate and focus on, this is the final message for this short presentation, lack of democratic legitimacy. How to get legitimacy? How to be more democratic? And I think the question is not a bureaucratic one. The question cannot be answered by bureaucratic means. A question cannot be answered just by establishing new and new systems, new and new committees, new and new political structures. The turning point has to be created in the South, in the identity. And the European Union, as we know it, in its present form, is, in my estimation, at the crossroads. And what we have to choose, and we have to choose, because we are the Europeans, stagnation, regression, marginalization, fragmentalization, becoming a kind of schanzen, you know, very nice. Schanzens, it's nice to visit, but it's not so good to live in them. Or to become a major player in the world based on the values of Western civilization. And the European values can be read in the European Charter of Fundamental Rights. I won't give you the whole list of European Unions. I just asked after the keynote speech what are these European Unions, but I didn't get quite the answer. But we have to somehow be aware of these values, because otherwise we cannot define who we are. The problem and the task what we are faced, in my opinion, is to create the demos. The demos, the subject, the purple in France, folk in German, which could represent the European population. It's not so simple task, because originally I was a student or a researcher of development of national identities, and from that point of view I can reconstruct the path to the creation of nation state and national identity. First, a nation, if it really wants to be a nation, has to invent national history. Second, it has to introduce a common language, and then has to outline the borders in order to be identified in geographic terms. Has to point out the city, that this will be our capital city. Has to establish bureaucracy, army, has to establish an education system, and of course a power system with a leadership which can be centralized or decentralized. And my receipt is that somehow if we want to see a European demos, then we have to follow the model of the creation of the European nations. I wouldn't say that we should create a European nation, but what I would say that we should create European identity. In psychological terms, and this psychological identity will operate only on grounds which are pretty similar to the structures of national identity. What kind of techniques we can implement? First, I think that we have to look back to the heritage of antiquity. So antiquity is a vast resource of those models, of those values, of those, paradigms of action, which can be characterized as specific European, which is not Asian, which is not Islam, which is not American. And antiquity is our gene, or man, to use a more modern term, our man on which the identity can be developed and flourished. The second reinvention of the meaning of Occident. Occident means Western, Westernity. And Westernity, according to the famous Hungarian historian Jenő Szücs, is in Europe the borders of this Western pattern of mind, the borders of Western pattern of social organization are where the last elements of Roman, Gothic, Renaissance and Baroque style buildings can be found. So this is the border between Western Europe and Eastern Europe. And European Union, I think, has to be rooted in the heritage of Western culture. And the border is from Atlantic to the Baltic Sea. And within this territory, from the Atlantic to the Baltic Sea, on the Western, on the territory of Western historical heritage, we can look for places of common memory. What I lacked from this presentation, what we have heard in the keynote speech about the European history, that there were no places. But these are places we cannot build up our historical consciousness. And also we have to identify, like in national histories, they will identify national, great national figures, great European figures. We have plenty of great European figures, and we have to identify their birthplaces, graves, sites of their activity, and we have to build up a cultivation of these persons, because they give the model, the essence. What for the next generations, what does it mean to be European? We have to create the space, the cultural and spiritual space for making of the European experience. And I appreciate very much your activity, because I see that what you do, exactly what I like to see to be done, that you create an environment which is endowed by meanings, and these meanings fuel our sense of European identity. Because the meaning of being European, it comes from outside, but it becomes internal as a meaning. So meaning is a bridge between the environment and the soul. Like in Kőszeg. In Kőszeg you have no doubt that it is a European city. And you can identify as a European city because you have been many places similar like that, and therefore you can you can refer. This is a European example of the space. We have to reinvent, as I already told, the spiritual and historical beginnings of Western thinking. And I think that the core of this way of thinking is the Western individual. The Western individual who, by virtue of his or her language, stood up to the totality. It's not my definition, but definition of Martin Heidegger, but I think it's a very apt definition, who stand up to the totality of what is, who is faced with the totality of what is, who asks the question, what is. This is the Western individual, and takes the responsibility for the answer. And two very important sentences I can quote. One is the sapere aude, it comes from Kant. Have the courage to use your own understanding. But we have another very important sentence. It comes from Eleni Hankish, who borrowed it from Friedrich Nietzsche. Aude vivere, dare to live, dare to live. This is a very important, I think this is the heart of this heritage of Western individual. We dare to live, which means that, of course, we are faced with the chance that we will be sinful. So it's not just a question of virtue, it's a question of sin. But we are living in a space which is pressed by virtue and sin, and we take the responsibility, whatever the result. And the last, my sentence, and I think it's also very important, that all this European identity matter should be imagined, built up from the bottom. So what we have to envision is a horizontal Europe, not a vertical Europe, starting from the committee, commission, and parliament, and other political institutions. Horizontal Europe is represented by cities, regions, associates, associations like your association, schools. So from horizontality, can we expect building up a Europe which finally results a kind of European identity? And maybe there is one point that I missed to emphasize, and I emphasize it now, that there is the question of language, of course. Maybe that with the Brexit we are lucky, now we have a language which doesn't spoken in any nation in Europe. Therefore, this is an international language. Without English, we can use it, and it's better if you use it and they don't take it in account because it's not very similar to the language of Shakespeare. But it's a lingua franca. And through this lingua franca, we can understand each other, and we can preserve, of course, all 27 local national languages. So there is no conflict between this kind of language which are talking and our home spoken language. So in a nutshell, this was my presentation about the prospects of European identity.